Hello everyone, for today's video is all about types of graphs and charts. So imagine you've got data and you've got questions, but what is the best way to visualize that data to get the answers you need? Transforming data into an effective visualization or dashboard is the first step towards making your data make an impact. So basically, this presentation is all about charts and graphs and what they're used for and their functions. And I'll give some examples of ways they could be formed, if there are any at all. Like different ways of making these charts. So bar charts are the most common form of data visualization. So they can be good for comparing data across categories, highlighting differences, showing trends and outliers, and revealing historical highs and lows at first glance. Bar charts are effective when the data can be split into multiple categories. So when it comes to how you present or represent that data, the first thing you think of when you want to create some sort of chart or graph is a bar chart, really, because that's the simplest chart and that's the most famous chart ever used in most forms of data. So there are examples of bar charts, which include the horizontal one, which is the first picture, and the last one, which is the vertical one, which both these are quite common matching. But there is a middle one called the stacked bar chart, which is like you have a key of different genres or different categories, in this case genres of film, and then you have to and then you stack them into color, the colors based on the amount of Oscars they won with this genre. So for example, the x-axis represents the name, is the people's names, and the y-axis is the number of people, or the number. And you have to have a title when you create the chart, because so that people will know what the topic is. Otherwise, they won't know without the title what is the data represented, what the data is about, really. So a line chart or graph connects several distinct data points, representing them as one continuous evolution. So using line charts to view trends in data, and usually over time, the data from previous time of month or the year will change. So the result is simple, straightforward way to visualize changes in one value, from in one value to another. So basically, line charts just show you the period of a single time, spanning like months or maybe years, that this particular category is changing, basically, like sales or business profits or losses or so. And here's some examples of line charts here. So the first one is kind of what you think a line chart should be, basically. It's basically like exchange rates to represent the in and the flow outs of data within the space of a couple months or so. So you can see, like, over time it rises and it goes down. So basically, that's the line that you expect. The second one is kind of different in a way. It's a bit similar to the third one. So same category. But it's all about the shops and how much they've impacted on that sales. So sales by store. You could do it by months as well, like, and monthly as well. And that's the same here. That's similar to the third. The third one's kind of similar as well, which are set in device sales like phones, tablets, and laptops. So it shows the time period of which these items have sold. So pie charts are a powerful way of adding details to other visualization. Alone, the pie chart does not give the viewer a way to quickly gain accurate information and compare it. So the viewer would have to create the content on their own, which causes them to miss out key information that might be crucial, that may be crucial in order to support their data. So sometimes I made mistakes when these charts are not really easy to comply to pile up the data, because you need to have everything right in front of you. You can't miss anything out, basically. Because one time I think I was in college or school, and I got some key information wrong. And I created this chart which kind of messed everything up. And I wasn't really happy that I missed a few data, so I had to redo the chart again, which is a pain in the backside, really. And it can happen, you know. And pie charts, that's why you need to make sure you don't miss out any key information that's necessary to create the chart. So instead of making pie charts, the focus of your dashboard. So try to use them to drill down on other visualizations. So you need backup data. You need to have them as backup, basically. So they're not really they shouldn't be the focus, because there's other data to support it as well, which makes it more comparable or more easier to present it. So examples of pie charts, there's the first one is a 3D pie chart and has the keys that are color coded. And you can see how big it is, but it's very vague because it doesn't have any numbers, percentages, or anything like that. It's just presented. That's why I said earlier that you need that data, the extra bit of data, so we know what, because it's very vague by itself. That's why, partly why they can't be supported on, be the main focus when it comes to presenting that data. And the second one, it kind of reminds me of school when you have to know your angles, basically. Like, you know, the orange one with the arrow has a square point. Like, the square is being directed with a pointed arrow. Basically, it represents, it's actually 90 degrees. It's a right angle or perpendicular line, like you say, if you're a mathematician. And there's 45 degrees, I think it's acute. And there's obtuse, which is up, goes up to 180. It's under 180. 180 is actually a semicircle or a straight line. And 360 is a full circle. I think you have to divide 160 by the number of data, and then you get your answers, or by the angles that are used to get the answer. And there's the third one, which has percentages. It says favorite type of movie, and then has all these percentages that are represented in a pie chart. So Histograms are graphical representations of data that organizes a group of data points using a user-specified into user-specified ranges. So it looks similar to a pie chart, except the histogram concedes to present the data in an easier visual format. So this is by putting the data that was plenty and grouping them into logical ranges or bins. So basically the data is actually grouped with each other instead of separate, which is what bar chart does. And you can see the image, like basically it's quite similar. All three of them, you will consider it as a bar chart, but it's not really a bar chart. It's a histogram. And especially when it comes to certain data that's main normally represented, like height, basically it's 100 to 150. Basically, you could group them up into different orders of height, and you could do the same with the second one, but it's been color coded. And the third one is similar to the first one, but it's actually separate. Because most people think a difference between a histogram and a bar chart is that a histogram is actually together and the bar chart is separate. But you don't have to do it. It looks similar to a bar chart, but it's been grouped, which makes it more easier to understand and to not worry yourself into drawing other things or to add other things to it like you would do with a bar chart, which kind of takes time. It saved you more time and energy. Scatter graphs show the relationship between two quantitative variables measured for the same individuals. The values of one variable appear on the horizontal axis and the values of another variable appear on the vertical axis. Each individual in the data appears as a point on the graph. So when I was in school, I remember, and college as well, because I had to retake my maths GCSE again, which I never really liked maths that much, but I did at one point when I was in secondary school. But when I got to college, I really hated it. Or last years of secondary school, I really hated it so much. So, and they tell you there's different types of correlations, basically. And the third one kind of shows you what that correlation is. I'm not sure what it is. I think it's mainly a negative correlation, I would say. So basically, that's what it is. So positive correlation is when the data and the item, the two quantitative variables have something in common, have positive things in common. Then the negative correlation is one negative and one positive, I think. When they have something in common, but not necessarily. And then the third one is no correlation, which there's nothing comparable between these two quantitative variables. I can't remember. It's a long time ago since I've done maths GCSE. And there's different forms which you can do the scatter graphs in. And this line is actually called a line of best fit. And here you see the second one. I think it's a negative as well. But maybe I'm looking at it wrong. I'm not very good with that type of thing. And it's a long time ago since I've done a maths GCSE. And this one's kind of like a scattergram. It's quite similar. And you can see the labels, and it's been keyed into group 1, group 2, group 3. And it's been labeled as x-axis and y-axis, which basically x is horizontal, y is the vertical axis. So So the Venn diagram, also called primary diagram, set diagram, or logic diagram, uses overlapping circles to visualize the logical relationships between two or more groups of items. Venn diagrams are one of the types of graphs and charts used in scientific and engineering presentations, in computer applications, in maths, and in statistics. So the basic structure of a Venn diagram is overlapping circles. So that's how the data is visualized through that. And the items in the overlapping section have specific things in common, hence why they are grouped in this way. The outer circles represent the items being separate. So just to remind you, I have three of them. And the middle one is actually what you think. It's the simplest form of a Venn diagram. So plants and animals are living things, the middle one represents what both of them have in common, and the outer sections represent what they don't have in common. And that's the same goes for the other two as well. So the first one actually has arrows and written text and shows you the relationship between them, between three specific things, different things. And same with the second one. The second one's the third one, it's a bit more. And it's more annotations, and there's a lot to include. I remember doing one for a science lesson in school, maybe primary or secondary, I don't remember. But I know I have done a Venn diagram before. So area charts show the change of one or several quantities over time. So they are similar to line charts, except the area between the axis and line are filled with color. So line and area charts are usually supported with the same kind of analysis. However, they cannot be used interchangeably. So line charts are often used to represent multiple data sets. Area charts cannot show multiple data sets clearly because the area charts are shown that they are filled with color, basically. So they are very similar to a line chart, except the area it's filled in. And as you know, they can't be interchangeable when presenting that data. And here's some examples of a few examples of area charts that you can see. So the way they presented that their data, I'm not sure if I would recommend it or not. For the middle one, I wouldn't recommend using an area chart for that. But anyway, that's how they want to present their data. And the first one has a lot of data variables just to show. And they also show a minus, which is not really often shown in that maths or statistics or anything like that, or any visualization really, to just only show the positives. Sometimes the negatives are important as well. So that's very good that they show that. And the third one is about music sales by format. And it shows different ways that music could be sold. But again, I wouldn't really use an area chart for that. But that's what they thought of when we're presenting that data. So, yeah. Gantt charts display a project schedule or show changes in activity over time. A Gantt chart shows steps that need to be completed before others can begin, along with resource allocation. So, a Gantt chart. I've done one in college. I remember doing one for an IT. And you have to, on my IT course that I used to do before I even got into film. And I've made one. It's quite easy. I never thought it would be that easy to make a Gantt chart, but I managed to do it. So here are some examples of Gantt charts. And you can see the idea of what a Gantt chart should be. So basically, it's the first one is exactly, it's a simple form of a Gantt chart. So planning, research, design, implementation, and follow-up. So basically, it shows you what you're going to do. And you need to, in the film industry, I'm trying to get into the film industry. And I'm studying things about the film industry to prepare me for it at university. And you do need to learn how to plan very well and be organized and conduct yourself in the best manner you can conduct yourself. And you can't slip up, because unless if you have some barrier that's kind of preventing you from planning very well, I feel you should, you know, have a plan B aside in case plan A doesn't go to plan, basically. And this is very good for planning things that are quite any lengthy projects that you have. Plan them out with a Gantt chart. I would recommend that for it. And the second one is with people's heads. I was supposed to make an apology in advance, so I apologize that the images are so small that you can't really see. And there's people's faces on it, who's doing what task. And the third one is basically color-coded with different items, different tasks that need to be completed. So they've been categorized, basically, based on the department that is doing these tasks. So, yeah. Box and whisker charts. I normally call it a box chart. When I was in school, they just called it box chart. So, a box and whisker chart is a statistical graph used for displaying sets of numerical data through their quartiles or something. I can't remember how to pronounce that. So it displays a frequent distribution of the data. So box and whisker charts can help you to display the spread and skewness for a given set of data using five number summary principle. Minimum, maximum, median, lower and upper quartiles. The five number summary principle allows providing a statistical summary for a particular set of numbers. It shows you the range, minimum, maximum numbers, the spread, otherwise known as upper and lower quartiles, and the center, which is the median, for the set of data numbers. So here are some examples of box and whisker charts. So the first one displays each line, basically what they represent. I didn't know what whisker was until I saw what it was through this image, basically. There's basically this long line that's going down, basically. And I don't really remember using dots for that, but I'm not sure. I don't remember using the dot when you have to plot. But in a way, I don't know if they're really necessary. I don't think they are, but maybe they are necessary for certain things. But I'm not sure. If you know about why dots are used, please put in the comments. And here's the second one. This is vertical, the vertical box chart. And the third one's the horizontal. So you could display them in any way in which how you want to portray them, basically. So pictograms are one of the more visually appealing types of graphs and charts that display numerical information with the use of icons or picture symbols to represent data sets. They are very easy to read in a statistical way of data visualization. So a pictogram shows the frequency of data as images or symbols. So each image and symbol may represent one or more units of a given data set. So here are a few examples of it. So basically, the first one represents CDs, four CDs. So you have a key and you have the category. You have to have one category and have subcategories and a key to show what it represents. And the second one doesn't have a key, but it does have these icons. So the fruits are more different looking. Basically, it's attributed to how a viewer looks at these fruits. And the third one is similar to the, it's basically like the first one. So it's categorized by the day of the week and shows you the, I don't know if it's the amount of cakes we made, I can't tell you that, what they're trying to say. You do need to have good art skills. I didn't really have that. But I can draw okay, but not in a way that makes people seem stunned by my drawings. That I'm a good artist. I'm not a good artist in that way, so. Organizational charts is a diagram that conveys a company's internal structure by dealing with the roles, responsibilities, and relationship between individuals within an entity. Organizational charts are alternatively referred as org charts or organization charts. So it basically shows you the company's hierarchical order and how each department really works together. So basically, that's what it shows you. The middle one shows you the relationship. It's been color-coded because there are different departments within that company. And the top is basically like the head of the company, like the CEO or chief executive, or it stands for chief executive, or maybe the someone who's a, you know, the owner of a business or something. And it shows you like different managerial roles. Shows you like lots of arrows because basically each department is connected to, through some form or another, and how they actually collaborate with each other. And the first one is basically, I'm really sorry about this, but they have faces on them, and it shows you the people. It's basically like a hierarchy based on the importance of each person within the company, each department within the company. So, and same goes for the third one. It's a bit like a family tree type thing, but it's not really a family tree. And in films, they have lots of different departments, which is really astonishing. You get any job in the film industry, you don't have to have a film qualification, you know. You don't have to study film in order to get a job. But you do need to show some experience in some form or another. Or you do need to provide something to support it in order to get into the film industry. Like producers, you don't have to be a producer. Apparently producers, you don't need to have a film qualification to be a producer. Well, so that's an example, I mean. Then how there's links between how a producer and a director work together in the film industry and many other departments. And if you want to be a production assistant, basically there's lots of jobs out there that can help you get into that. Now I'm currently looking for production assistant roles in film and TV, basically. So I could show you, I might make a video in the future about that. How to find jobs and stuff. We'll show you the hierarchical position of in the film industry. So I'll create my own chart in the process of that. So if you want that video done, I must try and work on that if you want me to make a video about it. Flowcharts are a type of diagram that represents a workflow or a process. So a flowchart could also be seen as a representation of an algorithm, a step-by-step approach how a task needs to be resolved, basically. And the flowchart shows step-by-step in various boxes and order in connecting the boxes with arrows. So here's some examples of flowcharts. And it shows you how things work, basically. How a lamp works, the first one, and isn't. How something works, basically. Within it. It's a bit like a circuit that you do in science when you have to create a circuit. And it shows you the colours, colour codes as well, to show you how it works, how it operates, and different shapes to say what the main thing is. Like there's diamonds, squares, rectangles. And this one that's 3D, there's one 3D shape here. And they mainly are 2D, but you can use 3D shapes as well, so. A pedigree chart is a type of chart that shows an occurrence and appearance of phenotypes of a particular gene or organism and its ancestors from one generation to the next, mostly common in humans. Show dogs, it was supposed to say, and race horses. So basically, it's like if you want to discover your heritage or your background, maybe you should create a family or how your ancestors are related to you. That's how you could do it, through pedigree chart. Or you want to create a family tree, you can use a pedigree chart. There's websites that you could do it on. But I'm not the expert on family trees. But I know there are websites for that. So, or you can hire a genealogist or something. So the first one is basically, I know it's small. I really apologize again. So the red basically shows the person's infected, and the blue one is non-infected. And basically they show you like different people in the family tree that are affected by a particular genetic disorder or mutation. And it does happen from generation to one generation to another. And it can skip generations as well. And the second is basically what you commonly know it as a family tree, basically. I know the names are very difficult to see. And the third is basically a family tree as well. And it shows you how two people from two different families marry each other, basically. Noble families. It basically has the coat of arms, which is the family logo or the family coat of arms. It just shows them that they're part of the nobility, I think. Like we have in England, we have a lot of nobility here. But I don't know much about that. That's not my area. But there is a lot of nobility in UK as well, so, and how they link with each other through these small arrows and stuff. So when it comes to easily being understanding, good looking, in terms of graphs and charts, pyramid graphs have a top place. So a pyramid graph is a chart in a pyramid shape or triangle. Pyramids 3D, triangles 2D. So these charts are the best data that is organized in some kind of hierarchy. It's a bit like an organization chart, but it's more visually appealing. So the levels show a progressive order, so from one thing to another. So it shows you the most highest form to the lowest. But sometimes it's the opposite in terms of food, what you need less and to what you need more. Basically, this is a 3D pyramid and has lots of diagrams and arrows. I mean lines to say what they are. And the key to indicate what they're trying to categorize. The second one is known as Maslow's hierarchical needs or something. So what this person did, Maslow, basically ordered to what we need less, to what we need more. So self-fulfillment needs, psychological needs, and basic needs is what we need as human beings, basically. The third one is basically what you see. So basically, you don't really see it that much, but I think it's basically about how two items, I think, come together. So that's why they're color-coded differently. Or they look presented in that way. So there are other charts that I haven't really included, including donut charts, which is similar to a pie chart. Hence, except it's shaped as a donut. Then second is a radar chart, which can be known as, it's known as a spider diagram. And dot plots, bubble graphs, and tree maps, which looks like a table. So these are the charts. There's more charts that I could have included, but just to save some energy, rather include the ones that we should all know by now, or we should all have seen or used to represent our data. So Here are the references. I hope you enjoyed this video. And before I go, you can use these. All these charts can be created through Excel or PowerPoint. And I hope you subscribe, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye.